Okay, so what we're trying to do is on matching in graphs what the goal was. And before the break, we showed the following. Okay, so GT be the graph on the first T edges, okay? So basically the prefix, right? The prefix of first length T. And let's denote E alpha T, a set of good edges, okay? What is E alpha T? Is a set of good edges present in the prefix. Or present in G. Redefine what good edges is. So, what did and let E star is max of E alpha T, okay? What corollary did we show? Right? This is the corollary which we showed, is that this E alpha T. No, a set of good edges present in GT. Like T differs, right? 1, 2, like here.
So max over all T.
Yeah.
What is max over?
Max over T.
Of the cardinality.
Okay. This. Okay. Then what we showed that E star is less than or equal to match of G less than equal to alpha 2 times match of G. This is what we showed. Okay. Now, when I say set of good edges present in GT, okay, this is defined with respect to the graph up until now. Like, think of this, that you have only seen graph GT, right? What are the good edges there, right? So notice that, and suppose if I define E alpha, right, if we define E alpha as set of good edges, E alpha is set of good edges, right? E alpha be set of good edges in G, okay? Then notice for this quantity, right? E star is, which is max of T, max of T alpha T is max of T, E alpha T, right, is greater than or equal to E alpha. Okay. Now, you might ask me that then, hey, how does this follow? Not be equal to E alpha T. imagine that graph just stopped at T, right? Then you have a different set of good edges, right? Do you agree? So why does that implies this? Actually, so suppose it stopped at T, then what you actually proved, if you notice, what you proved is E alpha T at that point, okay, is greater than equal to match of GT. This is what you showed, and it is less than equal to alpha plus 2 times match of GT. Right? So whichever E star you stopped, whichever E star is a maximum of all this, right? Now notice, so in particular I also have E alpha, I also have this quantity, right? E alpha is less than equal to is greater than equal to match of G. This we have shown. But now E alpha max over T E alpha 2, right? This is less than equal to some E star. This is by definition. Not, if I am not using cardinality, I should have been using cardinality. None of these pains are working. Do you agree to this? Forget about this. This is fine, right? This is what we showed. Now notice, this E star is a subgraph. What do you know? E star is with respect to some GT, right? I mean, right? So just let's call that is less than equal to alpha 2 times match of GT prime, because that is where the maximum happened. But GT prime is a subgraph of G, so its matching can only be smaller. So this is less than equal to alpha plus 2 times match of J, right? Okay, now you will see why. Okay, so this is present in GT. So imagine that you just stop GT. Then you have different set of good edges. Maybe all small degree guys came in the beginning, so everything is in this, right? So but what did you show? But what did we show is we have to show with respect to E star, right? So now what did I say? Look at this E alpha T, look at E alpha, which was set of good edges in G. By previous lemma, which I showed to you, is that E alpha is greater than equal to match of G. This I have shown to you. Now E alpha is less than equal to E star for all this, right? What is E star? Is max over T E alpha T. So whatever your E alpha, what is E alpha is nothing but E alpha M, when all the edges has been seen. So this quantity is definitely there in the maximum. So maximum can only be larger than whatever quantity this, but that quantity was less than equal to alpha plus 2 time match of some GT prime for which this quantity was maximized, right? But that is a subgraph of my graph, and hence this inequality holds. Okay, so E star is this. Okay, this is important point. Up to this point only. So the set of good edges with respect to GT is very different than with GT plus 1 with respect to GT. So just imagine that my stream just stopped at teeth, right? So now my set of good edges are different, right? Now you might ask, why we are trying to do this E star? Because we need to find some good estimate on G, good edges. So rather than finding an estimate on good edges, I'm trying to find a good estimate on E star. And if I find a good estimate on E star, I will also have found a good estimate on the maximum matching of G. Right? So this is all, right? And it's possible that E star comes very in the beginning itself. Now What is an idea? So the intuition is, look at some prefix of this, okay? I suppose this is the only thing which I see. Like, imagine that you have a window and you are sifting window, sifting window, sifting window. So from here, I will do some sampling. And based on that, my sampling, I say, hey, estimate of this is this here. Okay, estimate is this here. Fine. Oh, let's maybe, oh, estimate is this here. Oh, this is larger than this estimate. Then forget about this estimate, because anyway, I'm keeping maximum and that is good enough for me. Right? So this is what I will try to do. So like whenever I have some sample, right? I have some sample, I will try to think that looking at this itself, because look, I cannot wait till the end to have a good estimate on like whether you are a good or not. I will say locally, are you good? Right? If you are locally good, that itself provides me a good estimates on the good edges. But it is a local good edges. But local good edges is also good for global set of good edges. And this is exactly what this statement is trying to tell you. This statement is capturing to you that if you look at the, what does it tells you? Hey, let's look at the good edges here. 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 And notice, for good edges, all that matters is that this. Right? Whichever is the maximum is good for me. Right? So this is exactly what I would like to do in this sampling procedure. I mean, it's not very obvious, at least not to me also, why it works, but this is an intuition why this quantity comes in play, is that I'm trying to check things. Are you good locally? And if you are not good locally, then somehow I will ignore you, because maybe if you are not good locally, the chances that you will be good later on, you will contribute is very low, right? So,
not good locally means not good globally also. That's deterministically true.
That is true, but
good locally
does not mean that you are good. Agreed, right? This is good. So, if you are not good locally, you will definitely be not good, because what do you mean by not good? Because here itself, I have seen to you more than alpha plus 1. After that, I can only see more. But if you are good locally, it's good for me, because that itself provides me a good estimate, right? And this is what this statement tells us, okay? So now we are trying to get handle on something which we can get a hold of this. And what you do when you don't know anything in life, in these kind of things, you do geometric sampling. But what do you mean by geometric sampling? I say, you do it at different rates of probability. Maybe I need bigger sample to do this, and this we use all the time now. Look, this is the third time I'm going to use this sampling, right? So what do you mean by geometric sampling? Okay, fine. Geometric sampling just means that capturing things which are at a wider this thing with probability which is like 1/2, 1/2, 1/2 and things and this. So I will write it down explicitly what algorithm I'm trying to implement, okay? So that at least algorithm, even if we do not understand the analysis completely. Okay, so let me write down this algorithm. Okay, so let me use this. This is an approximation for Easter. Okay, so we will initialize S equal to empty set, P equal to 1, and estimate equal to 0. So currently I have nothing. And the rate at which I'm going to sample something is with probability 1. And I will reduce the probability as and we go further. For each edge UV, E equal to UV, okay, in the stream, we'll do the following. What are we doing? A, okay, with probability P, add E to S prime. So that's the first thing you should do. Okay? If E prime shares endpoint W with E, then what will you do? You should increase the counter. Increment. So I'm maintaining a counter for W, right? Okay. What should you do? So what I'm incrementing, if you notice, E prime has already gone, right? So E prime is going to maintain two counters, right? What it is going to maintain? One of his endpoint and other his endpoint. So if E prime shares an edge with E, he looks at the endpoint, suppose it says W, he looks at his counter W and increments by one, right? Now if this becomes more than alpha, what should you do? I mean, then you know that this guy is locally very bad for me. This guy cannot be part of the good edge. So I should delete, right? Remove E prime and corresponding counter from same. Okay. Counters from S. So basically S contains some set of edges and counter for each of these people. So E prime. So now you added an edge E to S. Okay. Now when you add edge E, it is possible that you will increment the counter of some set of people. The vertices, the edges which has come before you and who shares an endpoint with you, E, their counter should increase. E prime has come earlier and I have added to S. Okay.
What is this counter storing?
Storing how many edges on you after me are incident on me. That's it. So increment E C E prime. So if the counted number of edges incident after me on W, which is one of my endpoint, is more than alpha, please remove him and please remove this counter. That's all that I'm storing. Yeah, potential set of good edges, and I'm storing counter for them. So if any of them I deterministically are able to decide that it is not a good edge, I remove him and remove his counter. So every edge which goes into this initiates its counter. Like for me, that after me, there shouldn't be more than that many edges incident on this person. What did I do? Yeah, this is why it sounds. With probability P, add E to S and then you initialize some counter, right? C E U to 0, C E V to 0. Okay, so this is what you do first. So when you, with probability P, you add E to S and you initialize their counter. And their step B is this, okay, for each edge E prime in S, okay, if E prime shares W with E, you do these things, okay. Now it should be more clear.
So corresponding counters from S.
Look at edge, suppose edge has already, S had E1, E2, E3, right? Look at this. Suppose initially S is empty, right? So when ed is added, I add the counter, right? C E U C E V, right? So whenever an edge is added, you add two counters. So this is what is happening, right? So now with this, you know where the counters are coming. It's not something.
You remove both the counters of E prime from.
Yes, counter from says. Why? Because when I'm removing, this is a counter which is particular to E prime, right? It only is counting with respect to is E prime good or not. So if these two counters, I just remove because E prime is not in S at all. What? Yes. On the endpoints of E, right? E equal to UV, so CU, CEV. How did we define an edge? Good. I said an edge EUV is good if after me, on U and on V, at most alpha edges are incident. If mod S is large, say 40 epsilon square log N, then you know what, so if the number of edges has gone too far away for me, it's like, okay, fine, this rate is not good for me, I will decrease my probability and resample, keep the half the edges from here and run the process all over again, okay. P is P by 2, so I have reduced the rate of inclusion. Or if you do not like this way, think of this way. Okay, the, I mean, I'm doing it, so, but this will take you a lot of space. What I could have also done, I pick, this is what I mean by geometric sampling. You pick 1, half, 1 by 2 square, dot, 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 1 by 2 power some log m. Every edge when it comes, you put it in this, each of this with this probability, and you do counting business. Okay, this is what I could have also done. I could have done this in parallel. Okay, and if the number of edges here are more, I would have just discarded this. If the number of edges at any level, so you just discard that level. Okay, so you keep the level. What do you mean by level? Which level will be good for me? The level where the number of edges will be proportional to this. So what are we trying to do? First, try to understand what are we trying to do. If look at the set of good edges or set of or whatever E star good edges. If I can uniformly at random pick an edge from G, I'm done. Right? Because if I could have picked up an edge, a good edge, if we selected a good edge with probability 1 over G, I'm happy because then I will return. So I'm attempting to uniformly sample from my G, but I don't know the number. What am I trying to achieve? I'm trying, if I could achieve, so what do you mean by approximate counting? Look, I want to have an estimate on good edges, right? If I could have told, okay, uniformly at random sample edge, good edges, and suppose you are able to do this. So you give me this edge with some probability P. What is 1 over P? Is the size of that set. So now I do not know to do this. So I'm trying to mimic this process in some way or other to achieve this approximately. Okay. So this is why this works, because if I could do this, I could achieve this number. Okay. So I'm just, so another way of looking at it, each edge comes, you put down here, put counters. If any counter becomes larger than some quantity, just forget that counter. It means it is not this correct. This is not correct. We will be able to show. But there will be some probability where which probability is not too far away from the number of objects. For example, look at good edges. Good edges will be between some 2 power I minus 1 and 2 power I, right? Any good number will be between this and this, right? So probably if I look at that particular sample, maybe things are good there, right? So this is all. So this is just to keep in mind, okay? But this is actually what is happening, and we will be prove this formally. So you do this, and then what you do here? You remove each edge in S and corresponding counters with probability what? With probability P. So if you started with S, now you'd have reduced the expected number of edges that will be remaining in S is half of this, because you have reduced the probability to P by 2. probability P or with probability half, just to make you right, because all we are doing is given that they are belonging to this, this is just probability half. Okay? And D, what is your estimate? Is max of estimate, comma, mod s, comma, P. And why is this okay? Because after every edge, I am just trying to estimate E alpha t. This is what it is. Right? Why I am moving estimate at E at the end of every edge? Because that's the next edge and the next graph. Look at this max E alpha t. What is this? Like it's over all t. Right? So whenever I add new edge, I check what is my current estimate. Current estimate of E star or current estimate of E alpha t, good edges in the graph GT. This is a right, but what do I know? Max of all this is a good estimate for good edges in my original graph. I could not have replaced this with any number, but the max of all this. Look, to say that E alpha is less than equal to E star, I needed to use the fact that E star is max of good edges at every graph, every prefix, right? So this is why I am doing max of this, okay? And what will be my third step? Return estimate. So this is what it is doing. Right? So in the beginning, I am sampling with the probability 1, then
size of S is the estimate.
Huh.
Good.
But you divide by P, right? Because you are one, imagine yourself that look at GM is the last day because of sampling, right? So you believe that by doing this, you have sampled lots of sufficiently many good edges. Right? But you have sampled them with some probability, so you have to divide with the probability to get this number. Right? I would have ideally like to get one edge divided by the number of good. I am not able to do this, so I am estimating it in a different way. Okay. So now comes the analysis. Okay. So think of each, what is happening here is that algorithm is very simple. Right? What he does, I mean, it's some chooses something, but from where do these numbers comes? This comes from calculation. What do you mean by S by? If I have seen one edge, or if I have sampled one edge from this and I want an estimate on my omega, what should I do? No.
Why are you not keeping the whole S itself? Why do you want to?
No, S is anyway I am keeping a small. I cannot keep whole of S.
Why not? Because it's space. You can't keep the whole of S because you want to do it in polylog space.
Yes, it means then I will be keeping whole of the whole graph.
No, only good edges.
But that could be as good as.
Yeah, it could be. Right. So yeah. Space is an issue and that's yes. Why you're sampling.
Yes. If I have my omega, okay, and I told you that, hey, I am able to pick an element from here with probability P, which is uniformly at random, suppose, then can you give me an upper bound on omega? One by P, so same here, no? Yes.
So now if you do S by P, you are getting an expected number of edges that you have seen so far.
No.
In S, you are not throwing every edge because remember if the edge is not good, you are throwing it out. It's only the good edges.
if someone become locally bad, I threw you from S. So whatever S is, it is locally good up until now, right? Now what do? If you notice what is happening, but locally there are too many good edges, okay? If there are locally too many good edges, I said fine, then half of it itself provides me good estimate for this number, right? Because now I am dividing by what? Multiplying by 4 and reducing this number. Think of this way, right? Look, up to some point I see some set of S, or these are good edges, okay? How do I keep estimate of this? The way we were doing a sparsifier, okay, let's subsample it and let's weigh it with something. This is exactly what I am doing at this point of time, right? By reducing by probability, what did I do? I kept half of them, but I have given them weight 4. Like in the beginning, everyone had weight 1, right? That is an estimate on the number of good edges, whatever up until now I have seen, right? But after this, what I do, I say, look, now anything which I will pick, I will give them weight 2, right? How I do? I subsample them with probability p by 2 and I give everybody weight 2. Now everybody starts with weight 2 comes. Oh, this also became too much for me. Okay, now what should I do now? Okay, great. Let's subsample again. Right? Subsample again. Now I should give weight 4, because after this I am sampling everybody with probability half. So total number of good edges which will be there, I am anyway from there storing half. So this is 2 times this is a good edge here. Now from there I have subsampled half, I am weighing it with 4. Okay, now what should I do after that? Oh, this also became too much. Let's subsample again. Fine. Half them. But half should be this, so 8. But now everybody else I am sampling with probability 1 over 8, right? So whatever it comes, I have to multiply with 8 to get good number of edges. And this is what is happening. And this is what I mean by this is called geometric sampling, because geometrically I am decreasing everything and I am multiplying with a weighing number. And that is basically tested by P, right? What is P at this 1 over 8? So 8 times S. So I am keeping everything. Eh? Like I said, okay, fine. Let's keep the half of them and let's weigh them too, because that is the preservative for this. Okay, so this is the way to look at this process. At least this is how I keep in my head, and this is how I do it. Is every time I go down to 2, think of this, that I have object here with 1, I am giving weight. Now I have subsampled everything with half, so I am weighing with 2. So it is approximately equal to this number. Now everything from now onwards, I am sampling with half, which basically means everybody comes with weight 2. So that if I multiply with 2 times whatever I have seen, it is a good estimate to whatever I have seen. Oh, this also became too much. I subsample again, but now I multiply by 4. So everybody now 4 times remaining is equal to 2 times this. Fine. After that, I will subsample everything with probability 1 over 4. Fine. So this is like, of total things I would have actually seen is 4 times this. But the point is, you will incur error every term, right? So if you are able to somehow bound these errors, right? If you remember sparsifier, at every level we went down, we incurred an error of 1 plus epsilon. So 1 plus epsilon to the power, how many times you do this, that was the layer, that was the number of like error. And we said, oh, this is not too much for the kind of consideration we want. And if you are able to control that, you are happy. Okay? So these are the techniques which are coming again and again. Now you look at H, S, I pick first edge. I do a random. If it comes head, I throw him. I go to another, I do head and tail. If it comes tail, I keep it. Head, again I store it. This is what it means. Remove each edge in S and corresponding counter with probability half. Becomes too much. Whatever that number of too much becomes, I subsample again with probability half, which is like, so now this is why I am dividing by P here, because now less probability, so larger number to multiply with. This is real randomized algorithm in action. Okay, so this is what we do. Now we need to bound stuff. Okay, so what we want to show? With high probability, algorithm for E star outputs 1 plus epsilon estimate one plus epsilon approximation for E star. For E star. This is what we would like to show. Now suppose E star is between 2k minus 1 tau and less than 2 power k tau, where tau is twenty times epsilon square log n. This is what E star is. Like it's between these two numbers. Okay, these two numbers it lies between. So the way to view this algorithm also is that for each edge, I toss order log n coins. Okay, and I put him in the ith level. If if first I minus 1 it has come head, then I put him in the ith. So probability that you have put it in the ith level is half, condition on the fact that you have seen only head I minus 1 time. This is exactly what it is, right? So this is why you divided by probability half, because I started with p half 4th. So this is exactly what it is. So first thing is first. So hence the probability that an edge is sampled, that an edge E is sampled at ith level, well, at ith level is how much? Is 1 over, is pi 1 over 2 power n. Okay. Let SIT be the number of edges sampled. Okay. Let SIT be the number of edges sampled up to like okay, SIT be the edges sampled from E1 to ET, okay, at ith level. So what is an expected number of good edges here? What is an expected number of good edges? What is the expected number of good edges? What is the expected number of good edges? Look, expected number, what is the total number of good edges here? E alpha t, right? E alpha t is expected number, E alpha t is the number of expected number of edges which are good up until this. This is by definition, right? Set of good edges in G. Set of, okay, this was this. Set of good edge present in GT, right? So each edge of this will be present, will be with respect to probability pi. So expected number of good edges in GT is going to be equal to pi times this. Okay, so I want to see what is the probability that we are far off from expectation. Okay, so what is the probability that SIT, the edges which are sampled in this, minus mu is more than, okay, is more than equal to epsilon times pi e star. This is what I want to know, because I could be returning this number. So how much does this number is far away from this number? Do you get my point? So this is what I would like to count, where mu is pi e alpha t. So look at SIT, this is the number of edges which are sampled, right, at this point of time. I want to say how far away this guy is from my expectation, expectation of good edges. How far is this number from my expectation? Because what is SIT? SIT is also some p times total number of edges present here. So this is what I would like to know, that SIT is something which I have sampled, like which is my potential set of good edges, like, because how did we keep? Up until now I have found them as a good edges, like I have found no reason to believe that they are not good edges. Okay, so now I will apply Chernoff, and what the Chernoff will tell me? I mean, there are many ways to do this. Do you agree that this is fine? So what is this number? This is less than equal to e times minus, like, if just by Chernoff, epsilon square e star pi divided by 4, just by Chernoff, by simple application of Chernoff. And if you do maths here, this is less than equal to e times minus epsilon square e star pk, like 1 over 2 power k by 4, okay, which is less than equal to e minus epsilon square by tau, because what is tau? Is this, okay? So by 8. Do you see why this is correct? Because look, what is epsilon star pk? Right, e star times pk. So here, if you write down, so if you put 2k here, right, is this not correct? From here, what we have to say here, e star times pk, which is e star times pk, which is e star divided by 2k, is less than tau, right, from here, right? So which is same as e star times pk is less than tau. So this is what it is. Oh, now we want and lower bound. So we will use from here, and that is why we'll get 2 here. That is why you get 2 here. Okay. But this is like some 1 over poly n. Why it is 1 over poly n? Because of 20 epsilon square long n. Right? And this epsilon square will get cancelled, and whatever you will get is some 20 log n 40. So what did we manage to show? Now, if you do by union bound, right? So what do we get by union bound? So with high probability, by union bound, with high probability, SIT divided by PI is equal to E alpha T plus minus epsilon E star. Okay? For all I between 0 and k and t between 1 to alpha n. Because you have to just do this union bound over all of these things, right? So this is just 1 over poly n, and this is like some log n, and this is like alpha n. So I have enough poly n to guarantee that even if I do union bound, like what is the probability that one of these bounds are far off? Is one of these guys fail? So if you do one of these guys fails over union bound, if you do over union bound, then this is perfectly valid. So with very high probability, what are you getting? So everything, okay, with everything is in this range, right? But what is this? E alpha t is less than E star, right? So right, and that's a good estimate. Okay. What is the number of, like, where E star is bounded? Okay. So what is clear is that if, what happens? So if I never exceeds k, like in this process, look, I never exceeds k, then you are very much guaranteed that you will get a very good estimate with very high probability. But what happens if I exceeds k? No, you are not getting my point. Look, I am running this counter, right? So if, look, if I am running this counter, it is possible in my head that it stopped, this whole process stopped much before I less than equal to k. Why? Because what could happen that I am locally itself finding, look, I only go to the next step if s increases, right? But it is possible that s never increases too much, right? Then I is always less than k, right? Then this is perfectly fine, because this analysis is perfectly fine up to I less than equal to k. But it may be possible that I do this, I keep doing this, but I exceeded k, I is more than k, right? Then what happens? Do you get my point? Look, what does my analysis tells? If I is between 0 to k, t is between 1 to alpha n, then this is perfectly fine, right? Because I can use this to guarantee this. But now what you can prove that if E star, now you can show if E star, if STK is bounded above by 1 plus epsilon time E star by 2 power k, okay? which is less than equal to 1 plus epsilon by tau, then with high probability I never exceeds k. Look, you also look, my analysis only shows me that this is good if I is between 0 to k. It never shows if I can exceed, k. Like, look at this algorithm. I'm like, if I is up to k, then I do union bound and everything, and this perfectly holds. But what if I is more than k? Then we can show that with very high probability, this I is less than equal to k, and then we are happy. So that low probability event never happens. You need to show this, otherwise your theorem doesn't hold. Okay. Do you feel confused with this analysis? Okay. Let me try to explain to you other ways. Okay. 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 Hopefully this will be much bit more clearer. Okay. Let me rewrite this algorithm a little bit, okay? And this time I will do this directly with the good edges. For P in 1 half, 1 fourth, 1 by 8, 1 by okay? So I have chosen P, okay? Sample edges with probability P and maintain the following. What is SP? SP is E sampled and E has been sampled, and at most alpha edges on endpoints observed, alpha edges on endpoints observed since E is arrival. Okay, so this is what my SP is. I'm not doing anything. Okay, and so this is what I'm doing. So I'm just sampling edges and maintaining its counter. Okay, and I'll say cancel installation for P if size of SP becomes too large for me, okay? Say 12 alpha times tau, tau is like some, what was that? Say 40 epsilon square log, okay? Do you get point? So I'm just sampling at every rate. If some sample becomes too much, like, right? So what, E sample and at most alpha edges incident on this, right? So if this sample at any point of time becomes too large, just ignore this sample, great. This is first. Return SP by P, okay? For largest value of P, okay, that isn't cancelled. if this is fine, right? So I am storing edges at different rates, okay, and I am returning to you for whichever installation doesn't. So let's make some claim now. Maybe this is a bit more cleaner to analyze. Claim, if P is less than equal to 2 times G, okay, then installation for P won't be cancelled, okay. Okay, if P is less than 2T by J, 2 tau by G, then installation for P won't be cancelled. Okay, let me prove this. So as always, GT be the number of good edges, okay, in GT. So like only T edges we are streaming consider, okay. So there also we knew that GT is less than equal to alpha plus 2 times match of G, which is less than equal to alpha times G, because G was greater than equal to match. Look, GT is less than alpha of match of GT, which is less than equal to match of G, which is less than equal to G. We have shown this. Let X equal to SP at time T. Okay, so what is an expectation of X? GT times P, which is less than equal to alpha plus, what is GT? Alpha plus 2 times GP, right? Which is less than equal to, can I write, what is? So we are in this case, right? So GP is 2 tau. Right? 2 tau. So this is less than equal to 6 times alpha tau. Like this is 4 and GP is 2 tau. Right? Assume alpha is 1, so this is 1. And now what is the probability that X is greater than equal to 36 times alpha tau, right? Look, this is less than, expectation of X is like 6 alpha 2 and this is more than 6 times. So then I can write down this is 2 times minus 36 alpha t, right, which is less than equal to 1 over poly n, okay. This is, I applied Chernoff bound. Okay, so what did we learn? So if P is less than this, you will not be cancelling this. X is never more than 36 times alpha T. Look, what was X? S, like cardinality of set SP at time T. With very high probability, it is much smaller. Right? It won't be cancelled. That's all that it said. Right? So this is good. And now what do I have to show to you? If P is at least tau by Z, then with high probability SP by P is equal to 1 plus minus G. Then I will be done. Look, what did this analysis told you? That look at the rate at P2T by U, like look at for P2, the sets there which you will store is not too large, right? And hence it will not be cancelled. This is exactly what it showed to you, right? Now I have to say that look, if P is more than this by this, and which is the case because one of these guys, then we are okay with very high good, okay? Again, do, what is an expectation of X? X is sp at the end of the stream, okay? X equal to sp at the end of a stream, okay? Then what is an expectation of X? Is gp, right? Because these are good edges into p, which is at least how much? Tau. Because I am in the case when gp is at least tau. So what is the probability that x minus expectation of x is more than equal to, let's say, epsilon times epsilon x? I cannot use anything, and this is like e times minus 2 times e minus epsilon square gp by 3. I mean, depends on what Chernoff bound you are going to apply, and you substitute here everything. So this is equal to 2 times e minus e square. What is gp? Is upper bounded by tau by 3. And what is this? Why write epsilon square tau? This is not e, epsilon square. And what is it? This is again something like 1 over poly n. So you are happening with high probability, you will return this. That's it. Look, so this is much cleaner, right? So what I am doing, but look, what happens is that if you do this, you have an extra log n factor, right? But if you do this, you are doing exactly the same thing, but you are able to avoid an extra log n factor, because you are not keeping here. I am keeping, it is possible that I might be keeping log n counters, like log n sets, right? So this is what people used to do previously, okay? And of course, it makes the analysis very, very clean. GT be the good edge in GT for this bound, this is never cancelled, so great. So it is there, estimate. And secondly, even P is this, estimate is between 1 plus epsilon, apply Chernoff, throw it down, you are done, okay? Good. So we will move to, okay, question? Now we are going to the world of small matchings, and we will see first time. So up until now, all the algorithms, remember this algorithm, we'll make it in work in dynamic stream with a much smaller space, estimating this in dynamic stream, but a space like n to the power 1 minus epsilon, okay, using this algorithm and the algorithm which I will teach from now onwards, okay? So this algorithm, what I call small matching. Not required. Okay. So this is largely motivated by parameterized algorithms. So this is called small matching. So let's for now insertion only stream. But I have an additional promise. Promise is maximum matching is at most k throughout. Right? But notice, if I had both edge insertion and deletion, then either I force myself that even when you delete or do something, matching won't change, or like, but it could be that all, if I can guarantee that at the end there is a matching of size k, that doesn't mean that in the middle I have a matching of size k. But here, if I told you at the end matching is size k, maximum matching is size k, then throughout the, because I am only adding edges, this. But if I told you that at the end edge has maximum matching its size k, but I allow both edge insertion and deletion, in the middle time I could have matching much 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 larger, right? So handling that beast is altogether requires different set of tricks and techniques, which we will handle gradually. Okay, so for now I'm promised that maximum matching is at most k, and now you ask, you edges are coming, can you store small number of objects? A small number of objects such that we can find a max matching of size k, say deterministic. So what is the promise? That maximum matching is at most k throughout. I mean, which is same as, and since it is insertion only stream, I can say that G has max matching at most k. How will you do this? Even if you do not understand what is it, it has nothing to do with this. All this is all that. So you can think completely fresh, make your all installation to empty and think. Because now you are returning a matching, so hoping that poly log n is, so you will have to store some poly k, okay? So, but you need log n because you need log n bits. So I'm happy with k to the power of 1 and tilde. At least someone I told this algorithm few days back. Just for those people who disregard anything which many people say, this is exactly what they did in Soda 16. I mean, people who love stock, fox, soda, so just for that purpose. By the way, first dynamic algorithm for maximum matching is actually basically something which we knew, like order root m update is, I mean, like, it's just that nobody told us the problem. We always knew the solution. Okay, anyway, at least some people I told the solution a few days back. Or in fact, at least all of you know the solution to this problem. I mean, Sita is wife of Ram. I said, right, we would like to keep a small sketch of my graph such that we can answer the following question. G has a maximum matching of size k, then with very high probability, that from looking at sketch, I can say, hey, here is your max matching of size k. But since I told deterministic, I mean, you don't even need very high probability. So what will we do? Abhishek, no. How many of you know kernel for vertex cover? Bus kernel for vertex cover. Okay. So just try to implement bus kernel for vertex cover, but thinking that it is maximum matching. Or rather, let's try to maintain a bus kernel for vertex cover of size 2k. So what will we do? Okay, so?
So I have at least one edge inserted on this one.
Not very clear, but fine. We have 18 minutes. So, I mean, this is an answer which we actually give 18 minutes. So let's, when edges are coming, so whatever edges come, I have some vertices v1, v2, okay? Okay, so let's look at this graph, okay? Let's look at this graph, and here is my high degree vertex, okay? High degree vertex, and let's, for now, let's say high degree. So in general, if I would have been maintaining a vertex cover of size 2k, what will I do? If I look at this, look, all the high degree vertices must go into the solution. So we would have generally deleted this guys, okay? But we also have learned this kernel, right? Where if high degree has lots of edges, then we keep all but k plus 1 edges, right? All right? And here, if you look at, this is a low degree graph, right? This is a low degree graph. Now, how am I going to store this? Look, I would like to store all of these guys because I don't know how they will be used. But I have guaranteed that there are only order k squared such edges. Right? And what is the property of these vertices? That everybody has degree at most 2k. If here we are assuming that high degree has vertex degree at least 2k, then all these guys has degree at most 2k, right? And hence all the edges here present, they must be covered by this 2k edges, and each of these vertices can only cover 2k edges. So the total number of edges, at least in this small degree part, is order k square. And here there are too many edges, but somehow we need to handle that out. So how will we go about doing it? But how do we keep it? Look, I only have limited number of space, right? So when edge comes, what should I do? So I cannot even keep n vertices because then that will take n log n time, right? So you get my point? How do I know that there are two vertices whose degrees are low to each other? Look, edges are coming. I don't know whether this is something which is to high degree, to low degree. I have absolutely no clue. So if I try to do something greedily, we have to find some smart way of doing this. I can know whether a vertex is high degree or not, right? But maybe it is a small degree or high degree, right? Maybe what could happen that lots of low degree vertices come and I don't know whether this is a low degree, whether it will become, how do you delete some vertices? You will delete some vertices because some vertex from here becomes isolated because you only kept small number of edges here. And hence that vertices is throwable from your graph. But you don't know that at the beginning, right? Even if edge insertion is coming, you have absolutely no clue, okay? So let's try. I mean, this is something which I haven't tried before, but let's see if this works, okay? So we will try to keep I think of this, edges are coming, I just keep them, okay? I will keep some e poly k edges at any point of time. And what will I do? I have this machinery which, given this set of edges, I compute, let's call this set H, I compute H representative, say 1000 k of, I compute H hat which is 1000 k representative of F. Suppose I do this. I can do this, right? Given this set of edges, I can run my algorithm without knowing anything, and I can keep this, right? So this is what I keep, okay? So what is left at the end? So moment, so this is like 1000K representative, means what? Okay, so what is size of each? E is 2, so P is 2, right? I think of them as a pair of vertices, okay? And whenever, so this is like 1000K plus 2, choose K, which is, or choose 2, because this, which is like roughly order K square, do you agree? Now let's call this H tilde. Okay, my claim is that max matching of H hat is equal to max matching of G. I would like to prove this. So what I do, I keep set of edges. If they become more than this, I compute my rep set of this current graph. And what is this 1000K times, like 1000K representative sets of this. So this is like 1000K. Each set has size 2, each edge, I think of them as 2 size set, and I compute this. Okay, let's see. So clearly, H hat is a subgraph of G, and hence maximum matching of H hat is subset of maximum matching, sorry, is less than or equal to maximum matching of G. Now I have to find, given a maximum matching here, I have to find a maximum matching here. How do I find this? Right? Given a maximum matching here, I have to find a maximum matching here. Fine. Look at this maximum matching of G. Let's say size be some k, right? F be m, okay? Let m hat be the max matching. Let m hat be the max matching of h hat that intersects with m most. Like, so among all the matching, I chose the one which intersects the maximum. Okay?
What is the problem in maintaining bus kernel?
How do I maintain bus kernel?
High degree vertices
and how do you know high degree vertex?
Currently, so far.
Okay?
So, somebody can move from low to high, then move it.
Yes? But there could be a low degree vertices which is isolated.
I'll keep that as well.
Okay.
Yes, I can't throw isolated vertices. But for high degree vertices, I'll keep up to k plus 1 edges.
Okay.
So if in the process somebody has become isolated again, can I go? No. Or maybe I need to keep it because.
In future, I mean, I'm not sure.
Okay, isolated vertices could be.
I mean, I'm sure there's a way to implement this. It's just that I didn't think through it. I mean, I only know dynamic algorithm, and I thought maybe before telling people dynamic algorithm, I mean, at least I should tell them how to do it insertion only with something like.
I guess the isolated vertices.
At this point, but I think that, but whatever you are saying, I'm 100% sure that we will make it algorithm, and next time I will tell you how to do this, but it just said I'm not able to, like, on the go, I'm not able to figure this out. I tried, but it didn't look like it. Okay. So this is not something which I prepared and come. So let m hat be the maximum matching of h hat that intersects with m most. Fine. Right? Now, look at the set of endpoints of edges which intersects. Look at the set of edges which do not intersect. How many such endpoints can be there? 2k. Now, of edges is present in my h hat. Fine. So let's call this edges. What does it tells us? What does it tells us? That look, if you take any thousand, if you take any thousand k vertices and you can find an edge in original graph which is disjoint, okay, then I can find you edge in this which is disjoint, right. So what were the property of these guys? So I look at my m hat, which is the maximum matching that intersects with M at with the most. So these are the edges which participates and these are the edges which doesn't participates with my M. Now what did I say? Let's look at all the endpoints of these edges, okay. And these are the edges which intersects. So this is the common edge and these are uncommon edges, okay. So if this is the maximum matching of size k, this is perfectly fine. If it is not a maximum matching of size k, that is the problem we are facing. Now look at your M, right. Why are you not able to find a maximum matching in H hat? Because some of these edges must be crucial, right, for maintaining the maximum matching size. So I said, okay, let's look at those edges which are, let's look at these edges or the, I think the rather easier way of doing this will be the following. Let's fix this M, okay, let's fix this M. What I do, so let's suppose this is E1, E2, EK, okay. Let's look at E2 to EK minus 1. What is the total number of vertices here? 2K minus 1, let's say W, okay. What is the property of G? G contains an edge which is disjoint from W. It means my graph H hat contains an edge which is disjoint from this, okay. Find that, let's call this H1, okay. So H1, E2, EK is also a matching, okay, fine. Now notice I look at E3 to EK and H, right. What does it tells us? If I take this, there is an edge E2 which is disjoint from this. It means there is an edge E2 which is disjoint from H1, E3, dot, dot, dot to EK in my graph. Let's call this H2. So I have got H1, H2, E3, dot EK, which is a maximum matching in my graph. Okay. Now let's look at H1, H3 and remaining except E3, right? H1, H2 and this E3 is disjoint from this. So in my graph there exists an edge which is disjoint from H1, H2 dot dot dot. Let's call that H3. So on and so forth, I can build this, right. So I don't need 1000k, all I actually need is 2 times k minus 1 representative. So I actually can get
O tilde K square vertex subgraph, which has a property that the maximum matching of G is equal to maximum matching of H hat. Okay, but this is only in edge insertion. Deletion, we don't know. Okay, so on Thursday I will tell you how to do this in what is it called, in deletion model too. And again, the only thing which we know how to maintain those things is what? Huh? No, that will not be under the promise, A. But only thing which we have learnt in graph algorithms, when to do something when there are deletion is what? Huh? Is L0 sampling. So we have to do some L0 sampling and that should be all. Okay?